What's the point? What's the point of having guns if you have no bullets? You understand? So we still playing with paper tigers. Like we trying to draw the biggest gun on a piece of paper and think that can compete on a world global domination level. The only thing that can distinguish us in this world from the other world is from us using our imagination. This is what I want people to do. Start indulging in things which cater to the imagination. Start things that take you, that like start beginning to see yourself as a being that has all of these miraculous powers. You understand? If you see, I grew up, like I want to give a shout out to my man Sadia Folks. He lives out in Germany now, but this dude, man, his father's a jazz musician. He used to play for the Lounge Lizards, and this was like my best friend since we was kids. And me and him used to make up comic books, right? And we used to like Marvel Universe, because Marvel Universe tells you all the powers that all of the superheroes have, their limitations, you know, their idiosyncrasies, who they are, their weaknesses and all that. So now we would draw our own characters, and we would put into our characters our limitations, our strengths. So I remember distinctively one of his character flaws was his superhero was allergic to peanut butter. So, because he was really allergic to peanut butter. So, as a superhero, like, you could defeat him with just peanut butter, a peanut butter gun. He could do everything else, but as soon as you get peanut butter around him, he'll dissolve. You understand what I'm saying? So we got to start indulging, even as adults. I mean, adults do this, brother. Adults go, when I go to Forbidden Planet, the original one used to be on 12th Street and Broadway. Now I think it's like on 13th Street. When we used to go there with me and the twins, the red, blue pill when we was kids, when we used to go to the Forbidden Planet, we was the youngest people in there. It was adults in there, homie. You know what I'm saying? They buying $200-$300 robots and shit. You know, they indulging in the graphic novels that everybody is so ferociously, like, open over. We been was indulging in the imagination. You know what I'm saying? They making all these fancy movies and all that. I'm like, come on, this stuff is old. You feel me? This stuff is old. And what happens is, whenever you create a comic book, right, and you have mad issues of the comic book, because whenever you talk about movies, you have to talk about comic books in this modern era anyway. Shout out to Asiya. He cracked the code with the comic books from the door. And let me tell you something, bro. When you go in and you compose a comic book, you're creating an alternate universe. And in that alternate universe, every character within that alternate universe has a reality that you invoke every time you read the comic book. Now, let's take the comic book, put it in the spaceship, time machine, and send it back 35,000, 40,000 years and put it someplace in the Mediterranean, right? After the people, they might not be able to understand the words. But once the people see the images and they see flying characters and all that, they're going to match the comic book to their living corpus of what they have in their literature. You know what they're going to mix it with? They're going to mix the comic book with their religious context. You understand?
Right.
You feel me? So whenever they want to go into, like the white boys made a movie years ago, they play jokes on us. They did it in Avatar when Jake Sully told Neytiri, he says, yeah, I'm from the Jarhead clan, right? He made up some shit that's in this realm and superimposed it, right, within the context on a planet in the minds of an indigenous people that automatically they said, oh, he has a tribe, and his tribe is the Jarhead clan. Like, he hit them with the roots. When he got them, he may have something that perhaps they didn't think about, but he approached it when he got on top of that, the flying banshee, the one that the grandfathers and all of them dealt with, right? That could have been a secret within their priesthood that they only do a particular amount. They could have already known how to get on it. It could have been something lost to their species, or it could be something that he acquired after he had sex with her, the ability to get on that banshee. You understand?
did Frighteners. I can't remember his name. That's one of Steven Spielberg's buddies.
Mm-hmm.
And of George Lucas. All of these guys are occultists.
Mm.
Now, your thoughts resonate on the second dimension. There was a black guy, I can't remember his name, spiritualist. He isn't conscious in the classic sense, but he has made contact. He's also a psychiatrist. Basically, what he was saying is every thought you could have ever had resonates on the second dimension. So a lot of these ideas can be pulled down from the second dimension. I'll give you a great example. Those characters from Dr. Seuss,
yes,
were pulled down from the second dimension. So you have a whole world of a guy who's actually going into meditation and give you these characters. Same thing with Harry Potter. This guy, this black guy, said, I've seen all of those people on the second dimension, Harry Potter. Now, if you need another black guy, Credo Mutwa said, with his interview in David Icke, with David Icke, he said that he seen Darth Maul in the second dimension before the movie came out. R2-D2, C-3PO, he's seen them all. So George Lucas and these guys, they're actually going into the meditative or dream world on the second dimension to create these stories. Star Wars, all of that's channeled shit.
Hmm.
So these things resonate on these dimensions. They said a guy in 1612 could have been thinking Harry Potter, this thing resonates, and someone in that whatever that lady's name is, she can pick up on it and give you Harry Potter today. So the second dimension is where a lot of these thought forms come down, where the wild things are. That's another one from the second dimension, that whole character scheme. So these things resonate and can be pulled down by these guys, these occultists, looking in that dimension, seeing what's happening, then bring this thing to you.
And the first thing you need to do to get on the God level,
mm-hmm,
is you got to start conditioning your mind.
Right.
And this is how you condition your mind. Everything that sounds insane, gravitate toward it. Everything that's logical, rational, common sense, throw it in the trash can. And what you'll do, you'll deprogram your mind till you'll start thinking mystical things. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Mystical things. Get any kind of sci-fi movie you can get. Any kind of fantasy movie, mystical movie. Even the cartoons, because they're teaching it to their children. And get into it. One of the greatest things you can do is study mythology. Any kind, because it all comes from us. Mutu. True sayings. So you want to deprogram the mind to not believe that nothing is impossible. You see, like they say, technically a bumblebee can't fly. The wings are too small for the body, but it don't know it can't fly, so it flies anyway. See what I'm saying?
Mm.
It flies anyway. Remember you ever heard people say, I grew up poor, and I never thought I was poor when I was growing up until somebody told me so?
Right.
Everything is an illusion. It's only your perception. Because remember now, a project house that we call poor in America would be a condo in Africa. Just depends on your perspective. See what I'm saying? So what you want to do is you want to start deprogramming your mind. Then the next thing here is,
we have these fancy gods that could do all these fancy things, but that's where your source of strength was at. That's what you toiled to defeat an oncoming enemy, was he came to tell you to abandon your imagination. When he told you to throw your gods away, he was telling you to say, fuck off with your imagination. Now deal with my imagination. My imagination is, God don't have no girlfriend. God got these fucking men with wings on, and it's just them. And then he functions through them, and that's it. Ain't no women, none of that. Now, you occupy this imagination. Don't you get away from that imagination. I'll kill you. Don't you have no gods that's female. Don't you have sex with your gods. None of that. You understand? So you start creating a stultified, slowed down reality that's giving you nothing. And all it's giving the holographic envelope that emanates out of the child's mind. Because the mind is the holographic window to time-space realities beyond the third dimension, beyond third, fourth dimension, beyond the physical dimensions of gravity, in the grave, in the prison of prisms, in the light, there is a reality that your psyche, as it's connected to the intelligent carbon in you, that you have a direct conduit to anything. Like, you can make anything occur. You can go anywhere. All this talk about aliens and all that shit, we making all that shit into existence. We bringing all that shit into existence. Mm-hmm. We're doing it one thought at a time. So why do you think that the whole agenda behind creating things is to create new minds? But check this out. How can I transdimensionally leave the planet if I don't have the physical accoutrements to do it? Basically, if I'm not melanated, I don't have the ability, I don't have a ticket on that joint that could take me out of the planet. Let's start seeing if our people can make a story that don't have the quote-unquote white man in it.